These lectures are going to be, the contents are going to be quite different from what you have heard so far. And the reason we are talking about jamming in this meeting on glass formers is probably because of this phase diagram that was introduced about a decade ago now, which has become famous. So there's temperature, there is an axis, which can be thought of as shear stress, and then there's a packing fraction axis. And on this axis, there is this jamming, draw it properly, jamming phase diagram, which was proposed by Liu and Nagel in 1997, I think, or 1998, saying that, which tried to combine the phenomena of glass transition and jamming into sort of one combined framework. So I'm not going to get into that issue at all. I think Jorge's lectures will focus on jamming versus glass transition and the whole connection and the aging issue. What I'm going to focus on is looking at, so let me just backtrack for a second. So the idea was that there is this point J, which is presumably a critical point, and that states in here are all jammed. And what do we mean by jammed state? Jammed states are states that are rigid so that they can support shear, but they're amorphous. So sort of generalizing the concept of amorphous solids that existed in molecular systems to sort of more generic soft systems. So the issue of whether this is a critical point, it's related to the glass transition or not, is not going to be the subject of these lectures at all. What I'm going to focus on is materials that live on this plane, so T equal to 0. So T equal to 0 materials which, and this definition, for the purposes of this lecture, are going to be the granular materials. So these are T equal to 0 materials because they're made out of big objects. And so if I put these big objects in connection with the gas in this room, there's no exchange of energy between them. So the thermal fluctuations in this room is not going to move around if I put ball bearings on the desk. So... So leaving aside the question of whether the glass transition and this point J or the jamming transition are related or not, there are still very striking similarities between the dynamics of granular materials and molecular glass formers. So the dynamics of these athermal systems exhibit features that are often very reminiscent of usual supercooled liquids and glass formers. So, for example, you see aging. You see very slow dynamics with sort of Vogel-Fulcher type increase of time scales. What else? So slow compaction, history dependence, metastability. So in thermal systems, if we leave aging aside, then there is a statistical mechanics framework that lets us analyze what happens in supercooled liquids. And as you have heard in all the lectures so far, So in thermal glasses or molecular glasses, so there is a whole framework. There is a statistical mechanics framework bigger letters okay will do statistical mechanics framework So I can, of course, so the concept that we had from equilibrium statistical mechanics go over partially. So we can define free energies, we can define temperatures, and we can define temperature. And then there has been a lot of focus, a lot of progress made in the last few years in looking at the statistics as, is this big enough? Statistics of free energy minima. And how they control the dynamics, et cetera. So what one would love to do is to try and construct a similar framework to look at the metastable states in granular materials, this athermal materials. So there are sort of two issues in granular materials. One is if I drive the granular materials, so they're non-thermal systems, so to keep them in steady state, I need to drive them. I need to shake or shear or do something. So if I maintain them in steady state, is there a kind of statistical framework? Is there a temperature-like variable? That would be analogous to looking at this kind of supercooled liquid problems where there is metastability, but still there is a well-defined temperature. And then there is an additional issue that would come in granular materials, which is how to think about aging. So that we are not going to talk about in these lectures at all. So no discussion of aging in granular materials. So the fundamental question that we are going to focus on in these lectures, I think the short description of what I'll talk about is there a temperature-like intensive one or multiple, it doesn't have to be one, temperature-like intensive variables in granular materials. So that was going to be the focus of the lecture. So the first lecture will focus on trying to construct such a framework. And then the second lecture, I will talk about some results that have been obtained using this framework. So is everyone with me so far? Okay, so in the title of my lectures, I said stress, the fluctuations of stress in granular materials. So let me just redraw the phase diagram that we had before. So now we are going to focus on, so no temperature. In the Lu-Nagel type phase diagram, I would have T sigma, which is some kind of load, and 1 over phi, the packing fraction. If I talk to engineers, they would draw a phase diagram for granular materials, which is very similar, but it's all based on the components of the stress tensor. So if I have a stress tensor sigma, right, then I have, let's say I have, so I have two, let's say, do two dimensions. I have two eigenvalues of the stress tensor, lambda 1 and lambda 2. I can draw a phase diagram in this plane. So I have lambda 1 plus lambda 2 and lambda 1 minus lambda 2. Right? So this is, and for granular materials, the one more characteristic of granular materials is the interactions are purely repulsive. So these eigenvalues are all positive. So this is basically my space in which the granular materials live. And because the eigenvalues, all the elements of the stress tensor are positive, then actually I'm restricted to this 45 degree wedge. This is where my granular materials live. So this is the point where both eigenvalues vanish. So the pressure goes to zero and the shear goes, stress goes to zero. But in here, I can have jammed state. So what in a granular context, what one is then concerned with is trying to understand the fluctuations of these jammed states And that is going to be the primary focus of this talk. So, but I'm going to start off by talking about how do we go about and what is the basic framework that one has to use to try and construct a statistical ensemble. Okay, so let me begin by reminding you of what we do in thermal systems. Okay, so this is undergraduate thermo. So there are fundamental assumptions that we have in constructing equilibrium thermodynamics or statistical mechanics. So first, let's look at a system that's isolated. So this is an isolated system. So because I have conservative dynamics, if I fix the energy of this system, so all states in here have the same energy. So I'm going to denote by microscopic states, which could be characterized by positions and momenta, or if I make up a toy model with spins, they could be characterized by spins. So let's say real molecular systems, my microscopic states will have position and momenta if I have n of them. So all of the states in here, since it's isolated and my energy is conserved, have the same energy. So all of these states have the same energy that I fixed it to, that I, my system has because it's isolated. So energy doesn't fluctuate, it's fixed. And then the fundamental ansatz that we make for such an isolated system is that the probability of finding such a microstate is the same for all microstates, and it's given by 1 over the density of states. Right? So this is just, I'm going over this because we're going to generalize and see where things start failing. So this is the density of states, which is sum over okay, any questions so far? Yes. When you make the assumption that they are equiprobable, so this assumes ergodicity and time reversal, and of course there's time translation invariance. Right. So what goes behind making this assumption? Is first of all, energy is conserved, so my system is Hamiltonian, it's time translational invariant. Then I have time reversal symmetry and ergodicity. So I need both of those to make this equiprobable assumption. Okay, so, but for the purposes of these lectures, let's just say that the fundamental, so I can build statistical mechanics by saying I assume equiprobability and ignore what goes underneath it. But it's a good question. And so, does that answer?
Well, so you said ergodicity must be assumed, but we are not at the point yet where we have to relate time average to ensemble average. That's true.
So more fundamental is time reversal. Okay, so this is for an isolated system, and then what? Yes, Rick.
Just before we go on, for the granular systems, can you say a little bit more what?
Actually, what you said about the stress eigenvalues was not very clear for me.
Oh, okay.
So what exactly are we trying to address as a problem?
So what we are trying to address as a problem. So maybe I should. So let me just illustrate. And I was going to do that, but I forgot. So maybe a kind of system that we want to look at in granular materials is just a sheared granular system in a coed geometry, right? So I have two cylinders, and I have things sitting in here, which are a bunch of, and I'm shearing this. And the kind of questions that we would ask is, OK, so if I look at this system, then I measure, let's say, the stress in one part of this system. So I just focus on this part, right? So this is part of a bigger granular assembly. So I measure in here, and let's say what I measure as a function of time is some stress fluctuations. Okay, so the big question that we are after, or the big plan, is to see if there is any way of predicting can we predict such time traces given, let's say, macroscopic quantities? So let's say, what is the vol? What is the packing fraction? Shearing rate, etc. Okay, and the question, and going back to what I said at the very beginning, the fundamental thing that we are after is there a temperature like quantity that describes the fluctuations in this small part of a much bigger system? Does that make sense?
This is when the granular medium is in flow.
Is in steady state, right? So of course those are the ones that we are interested in.
Okay.
As you'll see, we'll start from.
Right, but did you say you will not talk about when?
We'll talk about when these are in steady state. I'll not talk about is when things are aging.
Okay.
So non-stationary dynamics of these granular. But the focus will be on trying to talk about steady states of these systems.
Okay, but also the transition from this kind of flowing behavior to
jamming.
Jamming is part of
yes. What you're going. Yeah. You'll see how far we have got, but yes. Okay, any other questions? Yeah. That's real temperature, right? So that picture by Liu and Nagel combined thermal systems with non-thermal systems.
Okay.
So it's saying, I have temperature, and on this plane I have a load and packing fraction. So there are systems that can live only on this plane. But glasses, like thermal systems, have finite temperature. And they tried to combine the jamming transition in the zero temperature plane with the glass transition in. So that issue I'm not going to go into at all.
So we are just restricted.
I am restricting to zero temperature. So the real temperature, what we call temperature, is zero in all that I'm going to talk about. Okay? Also, I'm talking about temperature-like quantities, but they have nothing to do with the kind of out-of-equilibrium temperature that Jorge will probably talk about in his aging talk, which is for temperature in the context of non-stationary dynamics of a thermal system, which relates to fluctuation, dissipation, etc. Here it's a much more basic problem in my mind, which is, so I have granular materials, they're non-thermal, they are dissipative, so when granular materials interact with each other, there is either inelastic collisions or friction. So energy is not conserved, so it's not a Hamiltonian system. And so for those systems, can we construct some kind of statistical framework where energy might or might not play the fundamental role? It certainly is not conserved.
Well, I guess the confusion might be that in the jamming phase diagram, there is an answer to what the temperature-like quantity third axis, right? So your answer is
I'm saying that's not a temp. Well, yeah, I'm looking. Yeah.
I mean, as I understand it, it's also true that you are not at all talking about something constructed from the kinetic energy of these particles.
Right.
You're shearing.
That's right.
You're shearing it only to sample configurations.
Exactly.
How fast or how slow it goes
exactly.
doesn't matter.
Exactly. Right. So no. So yeah. So there are all kinds of temperature-like quantities one can come up with. So there is certainly in a granular material that's flowing fast. There's the kinetic energy of the granular materials, and often that can be related to that. Since it's a kinetic energy, you can call that a temperature, or you can relate that to temperature. My focus is going to be, as Sriram rightly points out, very slow, sort of quasi-static flow. So this driving is only sampling states of granular materials that are mechanically stable. So the analog would be, if you go back to in this school, you have heard about inherent structures, you have heard about free energy minima. This is driving that will very slowly take you from one inherent structure to another. Okay, so, and then the question is, are the statistics of those inherent structures describable by some kind of temperature-like variable. Okay, so does that, maybe that, so. I'll put this in quotes. So these are like granular inherent structures. And I'm using temperature-like here in a very, very broad sense. So it's an intensive variable that is related to the entropy in terms of some extensive quantity, right? So it'll hopefully become clearer as we go along. Other questions? I think there was, did you have a question or no? It's okay, okay. Okay, so where were we? Can we go back a few pages? Right, the previous page. Yeah, no, so the thermal systems one. Go down a little further. Okay, so now if I go back here, so this was my isolated system, but of course the most interesting parts in even in thermal systems, is when my system is not isolated. So I'm looking at some subsystem of this. So in here, my energy fluctuates. Right? So this system has some energy E. The total system has a total energy E total. And this, within here, the energy fluctuates. And what do we know about this? So let me just start a new one here. Okay, I'm going to start. So for this system, which is now in contact, so inside here I have energy which fluctuates because it's in contact with this bigger system which has energy E total. So what do we know about the fluctuations in here, given our thermal ensemble, that the probability of finding a microstate inside the system, given the total energy of the system, is 1 over some partition function. Right? So that is fundamental, our canonical distribution, which comes from assumptions of equiprobability. And factorizability of the density of states. So if I take both of these assumptions then the fluctuations inside my subsystem, so the probability of finding a microstate inside the subsystem is given by this canonical distribution. And beta, which is our inverse temperature, is related to the density of states. So this is the microcanonical definition of temperature, right? So beta is a function of E total and is given by this expression. So what happens when I bring this, when I have this system exchange energy with its outside thermal bath? Both reach the same temperature, so the most probable energy in this, so the most probable energy is given by equating and this is my temperature, right? So in two systems, in a thermal, given these two assumptions, my one and two, we know this is what we get. So this forms the basis of all thermodynamics. So I can define, for example, I define my free energy as at a certain temperature. So free energy at a given beta is E minus TS. And I can go on and define other ensembles, et cetera, et cetera. But these two fundamental assumptions go into describing the fluctuations. So, of course, when I, can we go back a little further? One more. So once I know this distribution, then, of course, I can calculate all quantities, right? So I can calculate fluctuations of the energy. I can calculate fluctuations. I can look at the specific heat. I can look at susceptibilities, et cetera, et cetera. Everyone okay with all of this? Yeah. Say that again. I didn't understand the question.
That a statement for
the fundamental hypothesis, which one? The two?
No, way up. When you talk about microcanonical, when you talk about equal a priori probability,
it's a statement about the probability of finding a microstate
of a particular system as you're watching it, or of another.
So the statement is that if I have an isolated system, and then if I could go and look at a state inside it, all of the so let's say I create. If it's isolated, it's of course not going anywhere, right? So it's not connected to anything. But maybe I have some way of going and repeating this and looking at different states. All of those states have exactly the same probability of occurring. So that's a microstate by microstate statement.
So as the system evolving in time, you're likely to find any.
With equal weight.
So it's for a particular system as it evolves in time.
For a particular system as it evolves in time. One system, yes. Yeah. One system. Okay, so what do we now do if we have and the kind of system that I was drawing before, which, let's say, our couette geometry, I'm shearing. So I have a granular system. So let's just imagine that I am, or let's not imagine. Let's now just replace our thermal system by its corresponding granular system. So this is now made out of large grains. So there are two possibilities. I can take these large grains. Why didn't this work? if I put these large grains in contact with atomic systems outside, right, then nothing's going to happen. These granular systems will not be able to. So let's say I put like small things, atoms outside, then this granular system will not. I'm going to put similar granular things outside, right, everywhere. So of course there's energy exchange, but now the dynamics, because these systems are granular, is dissipative. So energy is not conserved. So besides that fact, I do have now a system which is part of a bigger system. And now we can phrase this question. So if I want to, let's say now inside here, I want to look at the fluctuations of the shear stress. Right? So inside here, or I can look at the fluctuations of energy. So inside here, things are fluctuating because these grains inside can exchange energy and exchange other things with the grains outside. So there are fluctuations in here. So there are fluctuations, let's say, of energy, of volume, of, since I'm looking at granular materials where stress is an important quantity, there are fluctuations of these quantities. So there are averages and fluctuations of these averages, right, et cetera, et cetera. So the question then is there an intensive variable, or is there a kind of canonical distribution if I look at this microstates of the grains? So what do I mean by microstates of these grains? So that is actually an interesting question. So if I have grains inside this, of course, the microstates have to involve, the definition of the microstate have to involve the positions of the grains, but there can be all kinds of other quantities in here, right? So certainly it involves the forces that are on the contacts between the grains, but they could involve all other kinds of quantities. But let's say there is a microstate, and then the question we are asking is there a way of, just like we had the canonical distribution with a beta for the thermal systems, is there a way of defining a canonical distribution with an analog of beta here? Okay, so that's what we're going to focus on. And what are the kinds of assumptions that one has to make? And what are restrictions? What are crucial assumptions? What are more mild assumptions? And is it at all possible to define something like this? Okay? Any questions? Okay. So the first idea of a statistical mechanics was proposed by Sam Edwards almost two decades ago. Right? So there are two components to Edwards's proposal. One is that the dynamics of granular materials is controlled by the mechanically stable states. And then the second component is, so these mechanically stable states was called blocked states. So I'll go back and forth between those two names. And then for these blocked states, Edwards proposed, essentially postulated, that volume replaced the Hamiltonian or the energy function, and then everything was as we assumed for a thermal system. So what does that mean? He assumed that just like in a thermal system, all states with the same energy are equiprobable for a given system, that all states with the same volume are equiprobable. And so you just then, you know, given these two, given this and the equiprobability assumption, then everything just goes through. So you end up with writing in the Edwards a canonical distribution where this quantity X, which he called the compactivity, is the analog of temperature. Right? So this is a very special distribution, and it followed from assuming all of the things that we assume for a thermal ensemble. So equiprobability, factorization of the density of states, et cetera, et cetera. So it's just a complete parallel to the thermal ensemble. So X here, or X inverse, is just as in the thermal case, defined by the derivative of the log of the density of states, and omega of V is sum over all states.
Actually means stable in the sense that
just force balance.
Just
force and torque balance,
yeah,
on
so
every
it's
grain.
Not stability, just mechanical
no,
equilibrium.
No, it's just mechanical equilibrium.
Okay,
yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah, I should be more precise about that. Yes.
Taken by the granular particles, not of the container.
No, so this is V of nu, right, is the local volume. So there's a V total, which is, so just like there was an E total for my isolated system, there's a V total, which is the volume of the total system, and then the compactivity can be related to that V total. But if I look at the small subsystem, then its volume fluctuates, right? So this V of nu is the, so if you look at this granular system in Edwards' concept, I look at one small part of it, right, and one state. So there are some positions of these grains. And so the probability of finding that state with all of its various microscopic variables is just determined by what volume it occupies. And so this is the distribution. And then this X is related to the total volume of the system, just like beta in the microcanonical is related to the total energy. Okay? Okay, so a lot of work has gone into, then there are people here who have extensively worked on testing equiprobability. And so what are the kinds of things that have been done with the Edwards ensemble? Or what are the questions? So Edwards just assumed this and postulated this. So there has been a lot of work done on testing equiprobability. Is volume conserved? I can certainly construct systems where I, in an experiment where the total volume is fixed, but there is a question of whether my fluctuations exchange volume effectively so that I do get into this kind of distribution. What else? So there's also been volume functions. So what is this function V of nu? So how do I calculate that given a microscopic state, and there are all kinds of issues associated with that, and I'll not spend much time on that at all. I might say something about it. So the question I am going to pose next is, yes, Sri. So it turns out that if you take the Voronoi volume, like, so what is the local volume associated with grains, right? How do you define that? So depending on how you define that, whether if you do Voronoi or some other partitioning, things seem to matter, so which is not a very happy situation, right? So I can, in a thermal ensemble, I could partition my energy, and it still works. But here, the partitioning of the volume, how you partition and how you define the local volume seems to matter. But I'm not going to go much into that. But the main question I'm posing is equiprobability, well, there are two questions, necessary for defining a temperature-like variable? And then the second question is volume the only extensive quantity that one needs to consider? So do we need to replace volume by something else or add something else to volume, which is extensive, which is also a fundamental extensive variable that we need to consider when we're looking at fluctuations in granular materials? Okay, so for the next half, I have half an hour, right, for this. So I'm going to, so for the rest of this lecture, I'm going to look at what is necessary to define a canonical distribution. With So is equiprobability necessary? What is necessary? So No. I'm not going to be discussing the testing of the equiprobability. Okay, so short answer to that is it's still pretty much up in the air. There have been, like, Corey's work says it's very far from equiprobability. What I'll come back to saying is that let me come back to that. Okay, so in our granular system, let's assume that there is some conserved extensive quantity. Okay, let's call that, I called it Y in my notes. I don't know why, because I didn't want to call it X. So what do I mean by that? So I could think of natural dynamics that conserve this quantity, or if I'm just thinking of fluctuations, then the grain rearrangements only redistribute this quantity in my big system. Okay, but let's not assume equiprobability. So if I look at now a system with a fixed value of this quantity, then I am not going to assume equiprobability. So if I look at a state, a microstate, then that microstate can have a weight that's different for each nu. So what's the most general form that I can write down? I'm going to write this down and then. Talk about it. Right? So certainly I don't have, I'm looking at only states which have this fixed value of this quantity y. And what is z? It's the sum over all nu. So each state, each microscopic state is now given a weight that's different. The subscript mu is, okay, so the subscript mu essentially is denoting that this is like a microcanonical partition function. Yeah. No, it's not an index. It's for later on. So I can think of this as a microcanonical partition function. It's saying I'm summing over all states which have the same value of y, but the states don't have the same probability. So each state can have a different probability given by f of nu. With this, is there a way of defining a temperature-like quantity? Okay, so I'm going to do so now I'm going to take my system and again divide it into two parts. So let's say this part has value y1, this part has value y2, and y1 plus y2 is fixed to be some y total, right? And the question I'm asking is, what is the probability of finding a value y1 given a value y total? And in my looking at the literature, I think the best discussion of what I'm doing now is, and I have references to that in my abstract, is in the work of Olivier Dauchot and his collaborators, and a beautiful set of lecture notes by Olivier Dauchot. So it's done much better in there than I'm going to be able to do here. So what is this probability? So I'm going to sum over all microstates again. And then there is some probability that I'm going to write down in a minute. So this is the total system. So is my notation sort of clear? So nu1 denotes a microstate in system 1. And so let me just rewrite this. Maybe it'll become. And y nu, and nu is a microstate of the whole system, which is made up of nu 1 and nu 2. So let me just rewrite, maybe. So this p nu is f of nu. Just want to make sure I'm writing it correctly. This is a function of y1 plus y2. So let me just rewrite this and then it'll. Right, so I probably should have just written it that way before. So this system has energy y2, not energy, whatever the conserved quantity is, this system has value y1. Okay, and I have replaced, what I have done is replace this probability but by what I wrote before. So there's f of nu. And there's this microcanonical partition function, which is a sum over all the states. So let me just rewrite that. So this is still a sum over of all nu. Okay, now. Nu1 and nu2 are microstates in the two subsystems, y1 and 2. I've divided my system into two parts, 1 and 2. So nu1 is a microstate in subsystem 1. Nu2 is a microstate in subsystem 2. So subsystem 1 has energy y1. Subsystem 2 has energy y2. They add up to y total. Okay, so now, and this is a big assumption, if I assume that f of nu y1 plus y2 can be written as f of nu 1, y1, f of nu 2, y2. If this is true, then you can quickly see that I can break this up into two parts, and p of y1, y total, this probability then becomes z mu of y1, z mu, and mu is just denoting this micro, it's not an index, it's this microcanonical partition function. So this is exactly analogous to, so a reminder of what I would have if I had a thermal system. This would be omega of E1, omega of so if I assume this factorizability, and that's a very fundamental assumption, then everything just goes through. So then all of my previous analysis goes through. When I, the only, with the replacement that wherever in the thermal ensemble I had a density of states, I replace it by this microcanonical partition function for whatever is this conserved quantity. So just as a reminder, okay, so let me just pause there and sort of summarize what I have done so far. So if there is a conserved quantity, which I've called y here, we can give up the assumption of equiprobability and replace it, but still keep the assumption of factorizability. And given that, then I can define a canonical distribution. I can define a temperature-like quantity, which I'm going to call alpha, because of what's going to come later. I can define, this is like an inverse temperature. So all of the previous, all of the thermal ensemble thermodynamics goes through. I can define a free energy like quantity, let me call it F. And this would be the entropy of Y. And what is the entropy? The entropy is now defined not in terms of the density of states, but this more generalized microcanonical partition function. So all of the thermodynamic algebra goes through if you assume this factorizability. So and this canonic and the canonical distribution, right, so P nu will be now given by some z of alpha. This is the real canonical partition function. What will end up here is going, f of nu, e to the minus y nu times alpha. and the canonical partition function z, which is characterized by this temperature-like variable, is going to be f of mu. Okay, so what I have done is just said we can ignore or we can make weaker conditions or a different. So out of the two assumptions that we had in the thermal ensemble, which was equiprobability plus factorizability, we can give up equiprobability, still keep factorizability, and get this canonical distribution. So that's where we are. There is then this temperature-like variable. So if I have a conserved quantity, then I can define any questions? So let me just say then, what does this imply if we take volume, if we take the Edwards idea that volume is the conserved quantity, so volume is y, then if we ignore equiprobability, if we do not assume equiprobability, then I still have, I can write down a volume distribution, and I can define, I can write down a distribution for volumes, and I can define a compactivity. The distribution of volumes is now given by X is now just the analog of that. So what this is saying is that this kind of distribution is in some ways more robust than the equiprobability assumption. So what is this kind of distribution? This distribution is pretty special. So V appears here, X appears here, and the combination appears only in an exponential. It's not a, not, it didn't have to happen that way. Right, so what this is saying is this factorizability assumption leads to these kinds of distributions. So, so have there been tests of this? And there actually has been a recent work by McNamara, where they looked at both simulations of a tapping protocol. So you take granular systems, you take a bunch of grains, and in the simulations, there's a way of changing positions by tapping and experiments. And what they did was precisely check this form. And I'm going to say how they did it because we're going to come back to that. I didn't write it down. Okay, so how do you do that? Okay, so if you have this form Px of V, then if I take the ratio of Px1, so let's say I can create systems at two different compactivities, then if I look at that ratio, then I'm going to get so if I look at the log of this, then I'll get log of the z's, but then I should get this very special form. So I should get the log of this should have a linear dependence on volume with a coefficient that depends on these two, the difference of these compactivities. So they tested this by doing two things. One is by just looking at the global volume, and that has some problems. So I'm not going to go into the details of this. I'll come back to it later on. So if I plot this quantity then as a function of volume, then I should see straight lines. And the straight line has a slope. So what did they find? They found straight lines. They found that so from this we can get two things. One is you can check whether this is being obeyed, this very particular form. And you can also get differences between the compactivities. But you can only get differences. You don't get the absolute compactivities. So these are simulations and experiments. So let me say a little bit more about it. So what do? You look at distributions of volume. These are histograms, right? And if you can create enough overlapping histograms for different, let's say this is one tapping strength. This is a different tapping strength in their simulations. If I can create enough overlapping histograms, then I can carry out this procedure, right? So I have a volume V here in both distributions. You don't know what X is. So what you do is you just look at what you're testing is whether, so let's say I have P, I'm looking at the ratio of these two, right? And I find enough of those volumes to take this ratio. So I look at that ratio as a function of V, and then I see if it has a linear relationship. And I interpret that slope as the difference between the compactivities of these two. Okay, and then the question is that correct in the sense that does the compactivity then depend only on the tapping strength, or does it depend on only? So if all our assumptions go through, then the compactivity and the average volume should be related, right? Well, it's not an assumption. You're testing that, right? So you're creating. So the only thing you have at your disposal is this variation of the tapping strength. So you're creating histograms. And then let's say I take two tapping strengths and create this ratio as a function of volume, I get some exponential with a prefactor. Let me take, let's say, trapping strength 1 and tapping strength 2. I can take 1 and 3, 1 and 4. And let me check if the compactivity depends only on the tapping strength. In fact, the more crucial thing to check the assumptions of the ensemble, is there such a relationship? Right, so is the app, so because that's fundamental, right? Because this is my temperature like quantity. I don't know about that. No, X here is like a temperature. It's not equal to the average volume, but there is a relationship, just like, so this is the analog of saying there is an equation of state that relates energy, average energy, with temperature. So what they tested is that this compactivity, that there is indeed an equation of state. Modulo the fact that I never know, there is some unknown, I can only look at differences of these compactivities in this way. So there's an equation of state that you can construct. Which relates V to X. Okay, so then we have come full circle. And what this is saying, these experiments then say, and these experiments don't test equiprobability. They don't have anything to say about equiprobability, because what they measure is just this exponential relationship. Right? So what is this microcanonical distribution? As long as you it's sort of not testable by doing this kind of measurement. So what one could, yes.
Constant pressure kind of experiment, right? You allow the volume to change continuously or?
No. No, it's not a constant pressure type of experiment. No, it's not like volume and pressure. So this is actually a subtle difference. So your compactivity and pressure are slightly different things because, first of all, you're looking at only mechanically stable states, right? So you're tapping them, and you're looking at the mechanically stable states, the block states, and you're looking at the distribution of their volume. You could... Right, okay, so the first thing they did is looked at the total volume of the system, which is fluctuating because you're tapping. Okay, and it actually, the total volume, so in their system, the volume actually depends on the depth of the system. It's a three-dimensional system. So the compactivity changes with the depth, but the compactivity depends only on the average volume at that depth. So I can say a little bit more. Okay, so there are issues with this testing. So the first thing I said was the total volume of the system. Okay, so if you tap it, you look at the total volume of the system. Right, look at, you tap it again with the same strength, that volume fluctuates. So these histograms that, these histograms are the histograms of the total volume.
Is there gravity? I mean, these things settle or rise?
Yes. What I'll do is in the next, so I'll hook up in the next lecture, then I wasn't going to do this here, but I'll show you the simulation setup and the experimental setup then. But yes, so the first thing they did was just look at the total volume. So these are then histograms of just the total volume, no Voronoi, no nothing, just total volume. And that works very well. There is an issue, though, which is it's hard to distinguish this kind of linearity that you have to rely upon from what you would get if the volume distribution was just Gaussian, because you are being sort of dominated by things near the peak. And so then they went and looked at the local volumes, and there are actually issues. So if you take the Voronoi volume, so here they actually did the Voronoi tessellation, looked at the Voronoi volumes. The exponential form works. But you can also calculate the entropy, calculate S of V by just counting states. The compactivity that you measure from that local volume measurement is not equal to the derivative of the entropy with respect to volume. So there are issues with the local volume, and what these people say is that if they take a different kind of tessellation, it might work. So there are issues associated with the local volume. So there's this, so Rafi Blumenfeld has this proposal of using something called quadrons, I think that's what they're called, have the property that the number of quadrants you have is equal to the number of degrees of freedom. So there are all of these issues related with the volume. So I wasn't really going to get into much detail of the Edwards ensemble. My only point, and maybe that's, I should have emphasized that a possible, a better test, or maybe a more pragmatic test of the volume as a conserved variable, proper variable for granular materials, would be testing this kind of histogram measurements rather than focusing on the equiprobability, because this kind of distribution can arise even when you violate the equiprobability assumption. And the McNamara work is, I think, the only one that I know where they have tested this kind of canonical distribution. Yeah.
I mean, if you're like in I guess in this context here, your microstates, I mean, to the extent that you can't identify them very uniquely, they, I mean, each of what you're counting as microstates could be, you know, could be degenerate.
So I guess what I'm saying is this form of I have e to the minus v over something like temperature times something that depends on v divided by something that depends on temperature is more will never be able to tell you whether you had equiprobable states or not. But
But
I don't even know if we care. Right? So, but it does, if this works, then the factorizability assumption had to hold.
Correct. Now I'm trying to get a concrete picture in my head of what the equiprobability assumption
was
or not. I mean, whether we take it or leave it, what does that mean in a physical way? I mean, it's like I said, if a simple-minded way of thinking about it is if I wasn't identifying my microstates properly, the different so-called microstates will have different counting.
It could be
values.
That, or it
is
could.
Is it that, or is it?
Or
is there something
more to
it?
Could be that the dynamics doesn't have the kind of microscopic reversibility, which will give me the equiprobability. Right, but I don't know how to distinguish between those scenarios. Okay, am I stopping for this lecture? So the next lecture, I'm going to argue that there is another extensive variable, which in some ways is a natural conserved variable for these block states of granular systems. And, and then talk about what we get from that kind of ensemble.
Okay, are there any other questions?
Thermal system, you can do this hypothesis because of short range interactions. What's the pictures in the
similar
theory?
Similar, right? So you have to say that these two, if I put these two states together, then It's even more than that, right? It's at that microscopic state level. So each state has its own weight, but if I put two of those states together, then the weight of that is a product of the individual states. So I don't have a good way of justifying it. I really don't have a good way of justifying it. And it probably depends on I really don't have a good. I'm just at this point. I would just say it's an assumption, right? I think it's in the density of states context in the thermal ensemble. What we say is, you know, I have two systems that I've put together. There are short range interactions. How does the boundary matter if I go to a thermodynamic system? So things factorize. Here at the microstate level, I don't have that robust justification.
No, just one small comment. Maybe McNamara, they are trying something realistic, but as to models, and for example, spin models, people have tried a lot to check equiprobability, and there's lots of papers, and the conclusion basically is that it works amazingly well without one understanding why. It's not exact, probably, except in some limit, but there's quite a lot of literature on that, but not on anything realistic, but
So I guess what I'm saying is, of course, if you have equiprobability, you will have this kind of distribution.
Yeah.
But there are if you raise questions about equiprobability, I can still get this kind of distribution.
This is weaker in a way. Yeah,
this
sure,
is
sure.
weaker in a way.
Sure.
That's
but
all.
But even equiprobability, which is a little bit of a miracle, amazingly happens, which is already quite surprising.
Agreed. So all I'm saying, and I should clarify that I'm not saying things are that equiprobability is violated. I'm just saying there's a weaker condition to get this kind of distribution. So if you measure this kind of distribution, it doesn't tell you whether I have equiprobability or not. Also, the definition of a temperature-like intensive variable is weaker than the assumption of equiprobability. That's all I'm saying. Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't see you. I would have thought that this issue about the weak interaction, not weak interaction, one can simply test this for different volumes, and I would have thought if volume is large enough, then you have factorizability, and if volume in question is not large, then you don't. I mean, has this been done to look at various volumes?
I'll say it hasn't been done in terms of volume, as far as I know, but we have done in the context of the other ensemble, and I'll come back to that, where we have looked at the dependence on size. To do this kind of statistical description. Okay, so what are granular systems? So I guess the most, can I turn this? Yeah, so sand, rice, marble, steel ball bearings, these are all granular systems. From this very basic definition they're non-thermal because they're made out of big things, so temperature doesn't move them around. Their interactions are dissipative. So maybe I should say a little bit about that. So they're dissipative because, let's say, if I take two steel ball bearings and they hit each other, if I took all the degrees of freedom into account, then, of course, energy is conserved. But I want to look at the description at the level of the steel ball bearings. I don't want to keep track of how much energy goes into exciting the phonon. So that energy goes away. So if I look at the dynamics, I have inelastic collisions, or I have friction, because these are big systems. So the point is, these systems are interesting. I guess maybe that's the thing that I hadn't said before and hasn't been said in these lectures. So if I look at sand dunes, for example, you can walk on them, so they seem like solids when you're walking on them, but they can also flow. You have surface flows, you have avalanches. So questions about, are these solids, are these liquids, what kinds of fluctuations do they have, what's the relationship between response and fluctuations, those are all sort of open questions. And recently, so these have been questions that, engineers have wrestled with for many, many years, and they have empirical ways of describing response of granular materials, not only dry granular materials, but wet granular materials like cement. But over the last few years, there have been laboratory experiments which have attempted to characterize fluctuations in sort of model granular systems. So these two pictures are taken from Bob Berenger's lab at Duke University, and their model granular system is a bunch of photoelastic disks. So these are disks, so these are all 2D experiments. These are disks which, when you push on them, they are birefringent. So if you look at them, you pick up exactly where the stresses are large on a grain and where they are not. So these pictures have become famous as, in granular materials, stress gets transmitted in a very strange way through these sort of networks made out of linear things that have become known as force chains, right? So qualitatively, pictorially, you see this sort of very striking inhomogeneities. And yesterday, I think it was Rob who talked about dynamical heterogeneities in granular materials. So you do see dynamical heterogeneities. You see all kinds of static heterogeneities, dynamic heterogeneities in these materials. Quantitative characterization of fluctuations also goes on. So why do we even think that a statistical ensemble might be a useful concept is that fluctuations, if you look at them quantitatively, are often reproducible. And what do I mean by that? So let me, I have a few examples here. So let's see. For example, this is in this kind of QED geometry that I had mentioned even in the first lecture, this is stress as a function of time. And this is stress as a function of time very far away from this jamming point. So the system is strongly compressed and jammed. And these are the time traces close to jamming. Now, the point is, if I look at the statistics of this, I just look at the variance of the stress, that variance seems to depend only on a few macroscopic variables. So it depends, let's say, if I characterize this variance, it is reproducible in the sense that if I sit at the same packing fraction, that variance, it remains the same. If I change the packing fraction, the variance changes. If I look at these time distributions, what is the time between, let's say, these strong fluctuations, those distributions, again, are reproducible. So it has this character that we're used to in statistical thermal systems, that a few macroscopic parameters characterize distributions and fluctuations. So a different problem here, this is in this kind of a geometry, and these experiments were done by Narayan and Menon at UMass Amherst. So what they did was looked at, measured, so they had a transducer on the wall of such a flowing hopper. So what this is just a funnel through which these photoelastic beads flow. For Menon's experiment, it was a funnel in which there were steel ball bearings. So what they did was they put a transducer on the wall, and they measured the impulse, the voltage of that transducer. And if you do that, and then if you measure the time, the distribution of the time between collisions, so the time between when they see a signal at this transducer, again, you see distributions. So this distribution is very far away from jamming, so rapid flow. And this distribution happens when you approach jamming. So again, if I control the opening of this hopper, I get reproducible distributions. So that's probably the thing that I want to stress, is that these are materials which are not thermal, but they do have well-characterized fluctuations that seem to be reproducible. Let me see if I have another one. Forget about this. So then the questions are, then there are questions about what are the proper thermodynamic variables, what are the state variables. So for example, and I'll come back to this later on again, this is a measurement of correlation functions. So these things are becoming available experimentally now. So this is a correlation function of the kind we normally measure in thermal systems. This is a correlation of a pressure on a grain here and a pressure on a grain there in one of these two-dimensional photoelastic experiments. And what you see is this is actually not pressure. It's the total magnitude of the normal force and the tangential force. Here, it is pressure. It is the correlation of the pressure. And what you see here is, if you shear the system, so the system has a rectangular geometry, there's a normal stress on it, then of course the decay function decays anisotropic. It decays faster in one direction than the other. But it's also longer than an isotropic system. But again, if I reproduce the system, I put in the same shear, I see the same correlation function. So there is some kind of statistical, and it's not, I'm not saying anything sort of earth-shattering, but I guess what I'm saying is there are reproducible states in granular materials. Not everything depends on exactly how you got there. If under certain protocols you have reproducible states, in which you can measure fluctuations, correlation functions, and you can get them over and over again for the same macroscopic quantities. And so the kind of statistical ensemble that I'm talking about, of course, can be applicable only to states of that kind. But even in states, with states of that kind, there are very important questions. So for example, what are the appropriate state variables? So I don't know if you can see this. So these are experiments where you do a cyclic shear. So you take a system, yes, Rick.
What is shown in the inset there?
So this is actually showing the force network from sort of zoom. So this is the force chains. So this is the actual correlation function. And this is sort of a visual representation of the force chain. So the force chains are longer in this direction than that direction.
Okay. Yeah. No.
But not sort of color-coded or anything, just showing how.
No, it was reminiscent of something that was discussed earlier in the meeting in the context of metallic glasses,
uh-huh.
which was diffraction patterns, which become anisotropic when you apply stress on them, and even when you remove the stress, the anisotropy remains.
Stays. Uh-huh.
So there, uh-huh. the lesson seems to be that when you subject these glasses to some mechanical deformation, mm-hmm. there is a residual effect of that on the state of the system. So here you're saying,
so in granular systems, that's certainly true, right? If the preparation of the system determines what the stress fluctuations are, and at the end of this, if I have time, I'll come back and talk about that. But what I wanted to add here is what the appropriate state variables are is a completely open issue. So for example, these are experiments doing cyclic shear, again, two-dimensional. So you start from a square box, just hydrostatic compression. You distort it in some direction, then you come back to the square. If you look at the shear stress versus the strain rate, then it's terribly hysteretic. So you're doing the cyclic shear. You go you come back to the same point, but you don't have the same shear stress. But you take the same data, but now you plot, let's say, the shear versus the number of contacts, or the pressure versus the number of contacts, and they are very well correlated. So the hysteresis sort of disappears. So there is a question of are there sets of state variables in terms of which things are not hysteretic, that they are state variables. So those are all of the open issues that we are hoping to get some handle on by hopefully constructing some kind of statistical ensemble. Okay, so I'm going to stop here and switch to this and then come back to some results later on.
Number of contacts between grains.
That's right.
Number is very small. Is this a two-dimension or three-dimension?
These are two dimensions.
Oh, two-dimension, right. That's why.
Okay. Well, it's three per grain. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. And for frictional, that's the three is the smallest number
right.
that you can get for stability.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it's three-dimensional.
Okay. I guess I need light. Or is it okay? I need light to write here. Yes. Okay, so I'm going to switch gears and let's start 15 minutes. And talk about. So what did we do in the first lecture? We sort of went through what conditions are necessary or what conditions allow for the definition of a temperature-like variable. And then I talked about Edwards' volume idea and said that there were some experiments which show that a canonical kind of distribution works. But the main point was equiprobability is sort of a red herring in that context. Of course, if you have equiprobability, you'll get that distribution, but under weaker conditions, you get that too. So what I'm going to talk about now is another conserved quantity. That is natural for mechanically stable grain packings. And I would argue that any statistical, that any statistical picture has to take this conserved quantity into account. And I'm not the first one to say this. This was proposed. Edwards, after his volume idea, extended his ideas to include this quantity. So what I'm going to do is justify or argue, maybe in a hand-waving way here, why this is a natural conserved quantity. So let me first define this quantity, which is a tensor. And this is a bad notation, but let me do this. So sigma is my actual quantity, which is a tensor. And this is the summation symbol. And in a granular packing, so I'm going to define this in terms of, so these are, so if I have two grains, I and J, Rij is the vector joining their contact, and Fij is that contact force. My writing's too small again. Contact force. So because I can have friction, Fij is not necessarily parallel to Rij. Okay, so this can have normal and tangential components. So what I'm going to argue is that if I take all mechanical equilibrium states, so if I take all mechanical equilibrium states, so these are states for which on every grain I have force and torque balance, let me take the space of all of those states. So these are some big phase space that encompasses all of these states. I can divide up these states into sectors characterized by this tensor. So this is sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, et cetera, et cetera. And the sizes of these, in some ways, very very qualitatively denotes, let's say, how many mechanically stable packings are there which have a certain value of sigma. And what I'm going to argue is that two mechanically stable states, so let's say I have mechanically stable state 1 and 2 in two different sectors. So I have 1 here and 2 there. These two mechanically stable states cannot be transformed into one another through any kind of local fluctuations. So to convert 1 to 2, I'll have to do something that's system spanning. Each sector has a different value of this thing called the force moment tensor. But of course, I can have lots of packings. No, it's not. It's extensive. It's sum over all the contacts. Yeah, it is just extensive. It's called the force moment tensor. Exactly, right. Yeah. It's the integral of the stress tensor over the whole system, which is, so it is important that it's extensive. Stress tensor is not extensive. Pressure is not extensive, right? So this is extensive. Exactly. Agree. Say that again. That's right. Yeah, it is the Q equal to zero part of, yeah, sure, sure. I'm sorry. So what I'm going to argue is that, so in some ways, I'm saying this quantity is conserved, quote unquote, in this sense, that if I have two states that belong to two different sectors, I can transform, I cannot transform them from one to the other through some local fluctuation. And I'm going to use this to construct the statistical ensemble. So before I go into the statistical ensemble, let me try and, there are two ways I can show why this is a quote-unquote conserved quantity. So let me try and do that. Yes? These are the regions that encompass all... No. This is some phase space of all mechanically stable states. It's not real space. It's, right, so like I can take all ideal gas states and group them by what energy they have, right? So this is, I'm grouping them, but by what force moment tensor they have. It's not a partition in that there's an interface between them. It's just taking all my mechanically stable states. And if my mechanically stable state happens to have a value sigma 1, I put it in this box. If it happens to have a value sigma 2, I put it in this box. Okay? But I can have two mechanically stable states that are in two different boxes. And what I'm arguing is then I'm coming to real space and saying, you give me one granular packing, which has value sigma 1, another granular packing, which has value sigma 2. Local fluctuations here cannot take it there. Okay, it can take it to another state which has the same value of sigma. So local fluctuations can take me from here to there, but cannot take me from here to there. I either have to do something at the boundary, or I have to create an excitation that's system spanning. So that it's in this, I'm defining conserved in that sense. Okay, and maybe it'll become clearer in a minute. Okay.
One question. You know, one configuration characterized by certain stress and in a state of force balance.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a priori obvious that you can use non-internal rearrangements to produce another configuration with the same stress. It's not a priori obvious that you can do a rearrangement which again gives you force balance.
So you're asking, can I get another state which has the same sigma? So that's a question of the entropy of these states, right? So let's come to that, right? So the question of whether you can do that, and in some models we can explicitly show that you can do that. So let's come to that. So that's a question about how many states. If each of these sectors had only one state, then, yeah. Not in this argument, right? In this argument, so let me just, it's more like a topological argument. So let me come to that. And I'll do it in a hand-wavy way, and I'll do it in, so let me do it in the hand-wavy way first, which hopefully... So let me take a grain packing. And so mark all my contacts. Right, so these are contacts. I shouldn't draw them overlapping like this. They could be soft, but they don't overlap. They compress. So there are contacts here. let me try and draw them as rigid as possible. Okay, so I'll make them big so that I have to draw only a few. Okay, that's probably enough. Okay, that's probably enough to make my argument. Let's see. Okay, so let me do sort of a Gedanken experiment. So what I do is, let's see. Let me draw a line, just a dashed line. So this is an imaginary line that I'm drawing through this grain packing. And then let me look at all the contacts. So maybe I should have asked for color. Let me try and do this better. So this is my dashed line. It passes through these grains. 1, 2, 3, 4. Let me just look at the forces on all the contacts on this side of the line. Okay? And I look at all of these contacts and I sum up. This is the sum of the component of the contact forces perpendicular to the dashed line. Right? So I look at all of these contacts. And just by choice, I look at the contacts above the line. I could have looked at the contacts below the line. I look at all of these contacts. Look at this particular quantity. So the force component normal to this line coming from all of these contacts. Let me call that F1. So this dashed line has F1. Now, if I move this dashed line, so if I translate this dashed line up, right? And I do the same thing. I recalculate it. Because of the fact that this is a mechanically stable packing, so that there is force balance, this number cannot change. Is that obvious? Because what I can do is I can take all of these grains and squeeze them and just sum up all of these contact forces. So somewhere, when I have crossed this line, the force has changed. But it has, so somewhere in this system, where I've crossed this line, there is a force. And so I could replace it by just a one-dimensional system. And then, see, because of force balance, this number, all of them. So if I just translate this line, it has to be the same force. Let me come to that. Yeah. I just want to understand if that's going through, right? So just because of force balance, this number is invariant as a function. And I can do this to all components of the force. I can draw lines in different directions. So what does that mean? That to change F1, I cannot do anything just to the grains around there. I have to do something to the grains to all the rows, right? Because I cannot change it. If I do something to this contact force, which changes F1, then to maintain force balance, I have to do something to the grains here, to the grains here, to the grains there, so that F1 doesn't change. Translation of a grain. What does that mean? Sure, so I cannot change the value of F1, is all I'm saying. So certainly I can do something local that will not change the value of F1. But to change the value of F1, I'll have to do something to all of these grains. Because if I change F1, I have to change F1 up there, right? Because of force balance. So I can't do any. So if we do this more rigorously, then what you can do is, this is my real space grain packing. And let's do this for the moment for sort of infinitely rigid grains, which is simpler, so that Rij is fixed, right? They are just the summation of the grain radii. Yes, Rick. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Keeping the forces the same, but changing the force that
I'm saying
by local local displacement is an easier thing to think of, unless you're talking about hard particles. Because
no. Okay, let's think about hard particles.
I'm saying, how will it work if you don't think of hard particles? Because I think in this particular case,
it has nothing to do with hard or soft. It's just force balance, right? So let's say if I had a one-dimensional array. So if I had, let's imagine, so I can replace this system by sort of hypothetical grains,
right?
Which had contacts.
Yeah. No,
just these contacts, right?
Correct.
Which sum up all the contact forces in these rows. These better be the same for them to have force balance, right?
Right. No, but
so that's all I'm saying. So I'm saying if I...
But if I think of something that is not supporting the structure, right? But let's say if I think of an ellipsoid, right, which I can move around,
yes,
right? And let's say it's a floppy ellipsoid in the sense that it is not, it's not needed in order for the packing to stay stable.
That will not change F1.
Right? But
if it's floppy and it's rattling, it will not change F1.
No. But when I say floppy, if I have soft interactions, it will still contribute. It's just that the rigidity of the structure will not be affected if I remove it or put it back. Let's take
then
that particular case.
But then, if the rigidity is not affected, then it didn't contribute to force balance.
No, of course it will, because if I let's say put it in a place
where
it is squished, right? So it, depending on the orientation, it will contribute to the overall force.
Yes.
Right.
So if you change that,
and the force will change elastically everywhere. That's special.
Even for soft particles, I'm just thinking about force balance.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, and what happens? What happens to force balance?
No, so the forces everywhere will change.
That's right.
What's not clear is that the structure of the packing needs to change everywhere in a significant way. In fact, the answer seems to be...
I actually didn't say that the structure needs to change.
Okay.
Because the microstates have both forces and structure in them, right? So the forces will need to change, right? That's which, if they happen through structure or for infinitely rigid grains, just forces.
Right. Just by elastic rearrangement, the forces will change everywhere, in principle.
Which will then go through the whole system, right?
Yeah.
So all I'm saying is, a purely local change in the forces is not possible.
Okay.
I think that's yes. Yes.
Integrated across X.
Yes.
Then you get that.
That's right. So the reason I'm going to So let me maybe say that first. So the reason I wanted to say this is that there is actually a more fundamental. So the fact that sigma is in my quote-unquote conserved, it comes from the fact that the divergence of the stress tensor for a mechanically stable packing is zero. So if I look at sigma, the volume integral of this, I get Stokes. right? So then it becomes just a boundary integral of something. So sigma then becomes a boundary integral of some curl, right? So some quantity. So let's not even get into that. It becomes a boundary term. So for mechanically stable packings, sigma is certainly conserved in this sense, that if I cannot change it locally. What I wanted to say is that there is actually a more fundamental, it's sort of conserved row by row and column by column. Okay, and that's what I wanted to illustrate. So maybe that's enough. So what I want to say is sigma for the whole system, let's say if I have a M by M grain packing in two dimensions, and I'm just doing two dimensions now. So this is certainly true for any dimension. The divergence of the stress tensor going to zero and sigma being conserved. So I can write it in terms of, let me call it, that's why I was calling it F. So let me call it this way, FFX, XY, FXY, FYY. These things are sub-extensive. They scale only with M. For a M by M packing. So all I wanted to illustrate is that sigma, the force moment tensor is certainly conserved, but there's a more fundamental row by row, column by column quantity that's conserved, which gives you some flexibility in what to choose as an extensive variable. Because I have, I don't know if I have confused the rest of the people completely. So let me just summarize. So this thing, this force moment tensor of a mechanically stable packing, so as long as I look within only the ensemble of mechanically equilibrium packing, so force and torque balance satisfied, then two packings which have different values of sigma cannot be changed into one another without either touching the boundary or doing something system-wide. So if I imagine putting them under periodic boundary conditions, they'll never change unless I do something that's sort of like a non-zero winding number kind of move. I go around the system. Okay, so that's, then this sigma is certainly one choice of the conserved quantity that we talked about in the first lecture. So this can be Y. Except now, instead of having one Y, we have this tensor. There are other choices that people have made because of this. So I want something that's extensive. So I can look at the, so if I just look at this tensor, which scales only as M, so sub-extensive, scales only with the linear dimension, then I can construct other possibilities. So I can look at the determinant of this, which will be then order of M squared, and I can look at M times the trace of this, et cetera, right? So there are other possibilities. We have decided to look at sigma as the conserved quantity. Yes, Mitch.
On an ordered lattice, I can make a local change.
No, it hasn't come in anywhere. So a crystalline arrangement, which is mechanically stable, can be one of these states. I still do to change. So if I have force balance, And if I want to go to another force balance state, keeping the same crystalline arrangement,
so long as we're allowing to, oh, I'm sorry. So long as we're allowing to change the forces but not update the geometry, not move the grains around, I can make these local moves on ordered structures. And I was just wondering where the amorphous aspect came in. Or maybe I'm thinking about it wrong. I don't know.
Let me think about that for a moment. But you don't change the value of F1 along the row. So you're not going to change the pressure, right? So that's the point, right?
Okay.
Certainly I can create another force balance structure by doing something locally. But you'll not change the force moment tensor.
Okay. In this like case, there's only one state. There's no ensemble.
There's an ensemble of different mechanically stable forces.
Okay. So that's right. That's right. That's the point is it all comes down to the entropy of these sectors. So if they were just crystalline, there's no finite entropy of these sectors, and it's sort of not interesting. So I think that's where the connection to the glasses and the inherent structures and the free energy minima become interesting. Okay. So I can – what time am I supposed to stop, Sri? Okay, so let me just sort of cut to the chase and say, okay, let me just then allow me to say, okay, this is my conserved quantity, and then do what I suggested we do in the first lecture, which is now define a statistical ensemble based on this conserved quantity, right? So what does that mean? So let me first define the define the canonical distribution and the temperature-like variables. So now I have a tensor, and so the fundamental quantity again is this sort of generalized entropy. So the entropy of a sector. So going back to that picture of I had the mechanically stable states, so the size of these things are sort of the entropy, and that is, or let me write it this way, the exponential of that is equal to this microcanonical partition function that I've talked about before, which is sum over all microstates, and I'm allowing for these states to have different here. So now I have tensors, so I have to do that, right? So I have sort of a tensorial temperature-like quantity, and the inverse of this was given a name, again, by Edwards. He called it the angoricity. Okay, so I'll stick to that name because I haven't found a better one. And I think angoricity in Greek, it comes from anger or stress. So it's a very funny mapping of stress too. Yeah, so that's so it's the anger kind of stress, right?
Happiness.
Huh? Happiness is not part of this, right? So it's yeah. So I guess we can all become very unhappy. But for the lack of a better happiness is inverse angoricity, right? Yes, this is the canonical. This is the entropy. Oh, sorry. I did wrong. Yeah, sorry. Very sorry. Okay, so this is not. Let me just cross this out. I went ahead of myself. So this sum over nu, f of nu, delta, sigma nu, minus sigma. Okay? Sorry. So what is the canonical? So then we can go through exactly what we had done before. So this angoricity tensor has components that are defined as the derivative. Sigma ij. What? So this is the analog of beta in thermal systems. So there's a canonical distribution then I can write down. If you give me alpha, then this distribution is going to be, now this is the canonical partition function. Yeah, let me just write it and then f of nu. So the full stress tensor is the conserved quantity. And I can take so all components of it. Why not with? Just the trace will not capture all of it, right? Right, so the question of what to do, if I'm just looking at the global quantity, I can diagonalize it and look at the eigenvalues. But then if I look at local quantities, I can't do that, right? So I need something that is additive, extensive. So the components are the easiest ones to do. But people have worked with the determinant of this other tensor, which is not extensive. And because the determinant of this is not extensive, so I can't do trace and determinant. The determinant of this is not extensive, right? It's n square. Each of the components of sigma scales as the system size. The trace scales with the system size, but the determinant doesn't. Trace is one, but it's not all of it, right? The full tensor is conserved. So the trace is certainly one of the conserved quantities, right? Right, so I need to keep all of it. So the simplest one to do is just keep all the components because those are individually additive, right? And then I can define an angoricity component for each of them. Does that make sense? So it is funny in the sense that now we are dealing with a tensor. So just the trace will not do. Because sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma yy, all of these things are conserved quantities. So if I just take the trace, I am ignoring the fact that sigma xy is conserved. So if I just have isotropic, so there are no off-diagonal components at all, right? Even globally, I can still have local fluctuations of these. So I can't. You cannot make it a scalar.
No, what's not clear is that this is necessary to take all the different components to come up with a
I think it is, because it is a tensor that is conserved. So you can, and if you keep the eigenvalues and the principal axis, that works, right? So, yeah. Because, you know, if I'm looking at it locally, what eigenvalue am I looking at, right? So we can look at the fluctuations of the principal axis and the fluctuations of the eigenvalues, right? That's certainly possible, right? The simplest one to sort of put up in the exponential is just the components. Right? Because otherwise, you some nonlinear horrible beast that you have to put up there. The thing is, okay, so So if I keep this up there, the nice thing is this is linear in Rij and Fij. Right? If I don't do that, then it's some nonlinear combination of forces. So if these are my microscopic variables, then it'll be nice to keep those linear up there. That is a scalar. It's a contraction of the two. Yeah. Yeah, I do want a scalar up here. So, but this is a scalar. Okay, so what have we done with this? Okay, so what are we saying? That in granular materials, this force moment tensor is sort of a natural conserved quantity. And if this entropy is non-vanishing, then we can think of a statistical description in which this entropy, the entropy maximization plays a role in determining the nature of fluctuations, etc. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is show you. So again, this is sort of a pragmatic approach. Let's see if this works. Okay, and where do we expect it to work, and how do we expect it to work? So, what are the tests? Okay, so one test that I'll talk about is, let's say someone gives me, and for this, let me go to the isotropic compression. So the global stress tensor, I can look at only, so let me define gamma as the trace of sigma. So for the purposes of talking about the tests, let's look at only that one scalar component and see what we should expect if this ensemble idea is correct. So let me say someone gives me a mechanically stable packing which has two different mechanically stable packings. One has value gamma 1, so the whole system has value gamma 1, and this one has gamma 2. If the idea of entropy maximization, et cetera. So if the system behaves like a thermal system, except with alpha playing the role of inverse temperature, then if I take, so this is these are my grains. Let's say I take a cluster of grains here, a cluster of grains there. Then, and I measure, if I had a way of measuring alpha, then every part should have the same alpha. Does everyone buy that? Right? So this is a mechanically stable state. The assumption is it has come to this kind of granular equilibrium. So if it has reached this granular equilibrium, then these mechanically stable packings should have the same alpha, different parts of this, just like in a thermal system, every part of the system has the same temperature once it's equilibrated. And moreover, this alpha should be some function of gamma. So alpha 1 is related to gamma 1, alpha 2 is related to gamma 2, etc. Okay, so that's a test. So we actually did that, and I'll show you. Trying to see what I should do. Okay, so how did we test this? We don't. So, if I was doing a thermal system, then I know a priori what the temperature is, right? But I can so what I can test is, let's say, is the canonical distribution holding by trying to collapse the distribution of energies onto a Boltzmann distribution and see what density of states I get, for example, right? So if I can do that in MD, I can do it in Monte Carlo. Here, I don't know what the effective density of states is, nor do I know what this temperature-like quantity is. I don't even know if it's the same everywhere. So we want to test this and test, first of all, if the distribution holds, and what are these equations of state. So we had been killing ourselves trying to, this was 3-4 years ago, trying to figure out how to do this, and then I ran into Dan Frankel, and Dan told us how to do it. So this was his contribution. So this is what we do. So let me write it down first. So I take a M grain cluster inside my big system, right? So M can range from 2, 3, up to, let's say, a quarter of the total number of grains. So I have enough of them. So then I just like the McNamara part, I take pairs of these big boxes, pairs of these big configurations. So I look at P. So I look at a M grain cluster inside my first system, and I am histogramming gamma, which is, so if I take a M grain cluster and I measure gamma M inside it, right? So, and I do that histogram. So PM1 of gamma M is the histogram value at gamma M inside a cluster. So I divide this up into many, right? So all of the same M. So I can do a histogram. Yes? Gamma M is gamma inside this M grain cluster. Gamma is the value, gamma is the trace of this force moment tensor. But gamma is the value of the whole system. Gamma M is what I measure in an M grain cluster. Okay? And then I take PM2, so in this one, but I measure this at a different value of gamma. So I need enough overlapping distributions to do this. But let me write this. So I'm doing two kinds of pairs. I take two pairs of distributions. And so let's say I have histograms which look like this, right? So this is, say, gamma M. And this is say, gamma M prime. So the point is, I didn't do this. So I have to have enough overlap. So for this gamma M, I can get a histogram value for 2 and for 1. So this is the histogram from the first system. This is the histogram from the second system. And I can do the same thing for gamma M prime. Right? So I pick pairs of gammas, and I pick pairs of systems. And if my canonical distribution holds, then what this should give me is alpha 1 minus alpha 2 times gamma M minus gamma M prime. All the partition function stuff cancel out because of the way I've written it. And alpha 1 and alpha 2 are then these characteristic temperatures, which is the same everywhere inside the packing, of these two. Log of this, yes. No, 1 and 2 are two different packets, which can have different values of alpha. And the inside each, I pick clusters, and M labels the size of that cluster. Okay, that's sort of the way we did it. You could have done it by volume, too. Thermalizes it. So that's the question, right? Right. So once you have created that, is this? So then, if I do have that, then the fluctuations inside one of these packings is completely characterized by alpha 1. In this, it's characterized by alpha 2. And if everything holds, then I should be able to get an equation of state that relates alpha to gamma. Okay? And it should be independent of M. For M large enough. Okay? So we did this, and it works. So I'll show you some data, but I'm going to go to it at the end. So it works for, okay, so what does it work for? Where have we tested it? so this is one place we have tested it. We have tested it for quasi-static sheared packings, right, Max? Correct me. So these were just hydrostatic compression. We have also done it for quasi-statically sheared packings. So, and then we have used it to predict a bunch of stuff that we have compared to experiments. Okay, so this very sort of fundamental test of the distributions have been done only for frictionless packings so far. We are working on doing it for frictional packings, for experiments, but we haven't done it yet for anything else. But what we have done is made predictions based on this distribution and using that. So let me, do I have 5 minutes or 10 minutes, Sri? 5 minutes? So why don't I say something before I go to showing the data? So I'll show you quickly how successful. So this is really saying we assume this, right? We assume this, and let's see how well it works. So for now, trust me that it seems to work quite well for certain granular systems, both experimental data and simulations. But what does this mean? What is the nature of this this alpha, or what are we doing? So I think because in my mind, these mechanically stable states are the exact analog of the inherent structures that Sri talks about in Lennard-Jones glass formers, right? So what we are looking at is the statistics of these inherent structures. And what we find empirically, I have no fundamental derivation of this entropy, except in one case, is that the entropy, let's say if I just look at it as a function of the scalar, this entropy vanishes at gamma equal to zero for purely repulsive interactions. So if I go back for a moment to this phase space that I had, so in this language, this was my gamma. This was my shear, right? So if I look at jammed packings, and then we said all jammed packings live in this wedge, so nothing lives here, right? So this is my, so this entropy vanishes at this point. No, that we know. Right. So what is that saying? I don't think that's a surprise. But the fact that everywhere else it's non-zero, I think, is a surprise, because certainly for granular materials, what is this entropy? It's saying how many mechanically stable states can I have with this value? So for purely repulsive interactions, if I have no pressure, I don't have any mechanically stable states. Right. So I have to compress it. There's no cohesion in this. So I have to compress it to make it mechanically stable. It could have been that entropy, so it could have been that S of gamma stayed zero up to some gamma and then increased. But it doesn't. It seems to go to zero at gamma equal to zero, at least based on preliminary calculations. So if there is a point J, it's this kind of an entropy. It is sort of an entropy vanishing transition. And what is the entropy? We are looking at, this is now the entropy. So it is like this configurational entropy or complexity in the sense it's counting how many quote-unquote inherent structures or mechanically stable states do I have with this value of the stress. Right? And then it's in that space, you're saying that at gamma equal to zero, the entropy actually dives to negative infinity in what we do, because there are no states at that point. Yes, Sriram.
That's what I was actually worrying about. As you approach gamma equal to zero, some positive value, is it that the
exponential.
S of n, if n is the number of particles, or that is, I mean.
So it's an extensive up to, so I can write down what S of gamma.
So at that point, I mean, at that point, is there no configuration, or is there
at
some
extensive? At that point, there are no configurations. So S plunges to negative.
It's minus infinity, not zero.
Yes, that's right. So it crosses zero at some point. Right. So we can talk about all of that, right? So what? So but everywhere else there is an extensive. There's an exponentially large number of states, or maybe it crosses zero at some point.
If I understand you correctly, you're saying that the configuration entropy is zero at the J point.
That's right. That's correct. Or it's negative infinity at the J point. So that's the point. You know, it's how do you approach it, right? So at exactly, if I just approach it from this side, so below it, then there are no mechanically stable states, right? I come to this physical limit. I'm still unsure whether it is negative infinity or, you know, it's the old sort of spin glassy picture where we have done something wrong, right? So that, but certainly, entropy is finite away from it.
So would you agree if I define the J point as zero pressure quench of the ideal gas?
Zero pressure quench of the ideal gas.
Because that there the configuration entropy is actually maximum.
No. Well, these are granular systems. What is crucial is that it's purely repulsive. You have no attractive interactions. If I had attractive interactions, there's no way this entropy is going to. Yeah?
Until they jam.
Yes.
So that would be the J point, right?
Yes.
And that's where the configuration entropy should be maximum.
It's not. It is not. The number of mechanically stable states increases as you jam. And this is from Corey's data. So I'm just saying, you know, just empirically. The number of mechanically stable states as a function of compression increases. But maybe you're saying something else. I don't know. No, it's not correct. It's absolutely not correct. Because there are more ways of doing, yeah, it's not correct. Yeah.
I guess. Yeah.
But okay, so we can argue about what this form of the entropy is, et cetera, but I guess what I'm saying is the connection that I'd like to make is that this plays the role, I think, in granular systems. This S of sigma plays the role analogous to complexity or configurational entropy in glasses. And maybe that's what is the connection to looking at the glassy dynamics. So let me quickly just show you. Let me take, yeah, if you switch it. Okay, so this is an example of the tests that were done by Silke, who was a student. So this is what we did. So these are the histograms, and this is close to point J. This is far away from point J. So far away from point J, it's harder to get overlapping distributions. Close to point J, you can. So this is my gamma M. So these are these distributions. P and Q label these pairs now, so different systems. So these are these configurations. This is the plot of the log of this as a function of gamma m minus gamma m prime, which you see is linear. This is the collapse of the data back to what using these alphas. So this is what I would do in a Monte Carlo simulation if I knew beta and wanted to get the density of states. So this is the density of states modulo a reference alpha that we can never get out, because we can get only the differences in alphas. So we never know this alpha in an absolute way. And this is farther away from point J. Again, the test works fine.
The overall, the global density of your packings at some fixed value?
No, they're all lumped together. So all you're doing, all you do is care about gamma. Okay, so Corey, so these are Corey simulations. Corey gives me two configurations with different values of the global force moment tensor, gamma 1 and gamma 2. They could be sitting at the same packing fraction, they could be sitting at different packing fractions. We don't care.
Now, what is fixed for each case?
Gamma 1. Gamma. So each of these P's, or each of these histograms, has a given global value of gamma. So he gives me, so it's like microcanonical, right? So you give me, so these are all the configurations and he gives me, and these are where we generate the histograms. It's very easy to do in experiments, right? It's the global, it's the pressure you put on it. That's the most natural thing to do. Okay, so what are the other things? So I'm just showing you some couple of, so this is then alpha as a function of the gamma of this system, right? This is what, so this is like the equation of state. And the thing that I want you to take away from here is there is no dependence on the size if m is big enough, right? So this goes from m equal to 3 to about 32. It's the same alpha, and I don't want to get into the form of the equation of state, right? So this is one test that we have done. So what does this say? That just like in ordinary temperature, it doesn't depend on the size. It's an intensive quantity, and it's the same everywhere within a packing, and what controls it is, so if I change this around, if I control the alpha, it would control the average value of gamma, just like, so this is like the microcanonical temperature versus energy. Okay, I think I'm going to skip this. Let me just show you something that, actually, because of something that Silvio asked me, I'm just going to show something. So we've actually taken this entropy. So let me just go back. So we have no way of microscopically predicting this entropy. But what I can do is take these measured density of states and empirically come up with a functional form for the entropy as a function of gamma. If you do that, then what we have done, and this is like a two-minute thing, we can actually construct sort of an elasticity theory where the stiffness constants are completely determined by the entropy that we measured in these packings at that functional form. So if we take that, so there's a stiffness constant that depends in this way, and I don't want to get into the details of, but it's this gamma squared that makes the entropy go to infinity, negative infinity at gamma equal to zero. And what we can predict then are correlations. So let's say we can look at the correlations of the pressure. This is what was measured in Bob Berenger's experiments. And if we calculate those, there are particular kinds of scalings that we can get. So this is the predicted forms compared to simulations. And these are the predicted forms compared to Bob Berenger's experiments. So the point to take here is that stress fluctuations seem to be controlled by an elasticity theory, very much sort of like polymers, where the elasticity constants come from entropy, and the entropy that we're putting in is the entropy that we measure from these histograms. Okay, so the comparison is, so basically, okay, so what is the comparison? So essentially what I want you to take away from here is this scaling. So if I multiply S of Q by K of gamma, I get this 1 plus epsilon squared Q squared form. So the point is these are at different gammas, and if I multiply by K of gamma, they fall on top of each other. S of Q multiplied by K of gamma is supposedly independent of gamma from this, if I take this form of K of gamma. No, it's not. It's a number. It's a number, which in fact, so there are no adjustable parameters in these. So we have just taken the K of gamma that we said should work. We have taken the measured Z from the experiments or simulations and constructed this, and that's it. Well, this does depend on gamma. But it's a really small, so it's an unfortunate, this thing is sort of, it is a correlation length, but it's really a grain level length, and it does depend on gamma. Right. But that's not, so the main thing I want, the main thing is that it scales in this way with K of gamma. This is sort of a next level comparison, that which is the fall off, which we can talk about separately. But the scaling, the overall amplitude scaling with K of gamma is non-trivial. Okay, so let's just look at that. Other things we can, okay, so the other thing that I wanted to show, and here there is a real comparison, is these are the correlation functions that were measured in experiments. So the correlations do decay. The correlations are not infinite range, even though looking at force chains, people often say, you know, these are, so the correlations do decay. So these are the experiment, these are simulations, and these are experimental correlation functions, I think. Yes, these are experiments. And these lines are actually the predictions from the theory. So it's not bad. Okay, I'm going to skip this, but I just want to say, and I want to put in a plug for Max's poster, right? You have a poster somewhere, where we have actually used this idea that we have, instead of inherent structures, we have these mechanically stable states. So we can think of some kind of soft glassy rheology or Bouchot's trap model in the space of, in stress space, and we have predicted things that can again be compared to experiments. So let me just finish there. So what do I want you guys to take away from it? That we've sort of gone out on a limb and said that there is a tensor, which is a conserved quantity, and one can construct an ensemble based on that, replacing energy of the usual thermal system. And then we've just gone ahead and made predictions. We've tested what some aspects in some specific systems, and then we have gone ahead and used that. So now I can write down a partition function, I can calculate things. Let's just do it and see what comes up and see how far we can go. And so far what we have seen, the ensemble works better than we expected it to work. I'm sure it will fail, and I want to find a place where it fails, because otherwise it can't be that it works everywhere. Okay, so let me end there.
Right top, you've shown this curve. Is it the quadratic function? Or just an imaginary function?
Say that again?
The curve right under this results. Yield stress
the
versus
yield stress.
X.
Uh-huh.
Is it quadratic function?
Is the yield stress a quadratic function?
No, this curve, you show.
No, it's not.
It's not.
It's not. Yeah.
But it looks similar to.
Well, it's huh? Parabola there.
No, because we got exactly the same parabola
It's not. It's maybe it's close to a parabola.
Yeah,
it's not a parabola, but it might be close to one. But you have something similar.
Yeah,
in,
yeah.
Okay.
Very similar.
You had to do to get the angularity as the relationship between the angularity and the pressure. Did you have to do anything? Make any assumptions for that?
No. So the difference. So we can always, so what comes out from looking at the histograms is angoricity minus some reference angoricity. So what we did was we took the reference angoricity to be zero for very large gamma. So gamma going to infinity, and then that was the only assumption. And then the equation of state came out.
And what did you mean by modulo alpha?
So in that collapse, mm-hmm. there is an alpha reference, right? So that we didn't know. And then we had, so once you take that to be zero at large gamma, then you can extract out the actual density of states. Or given what I said in my previous lectures, it's not that so much the density of states, but this microcanonical thing. But all of the calculations that we have done are actually based on equiprobability, and it seems to work. So I think the equiprobability seems to hold here, too.
So can anything be said about when does the thermalization actually happen? When you pour the thing, or when you... can anything
so in this protocol, right, so I think when it achieves force balance, so essentially what it's saying is this whole system somehow achieves force balance, right? And once it, during that process of achieving force balance, it has to thermalize. So once force balance has been achieved everywhere in the system, then the temperature is exactly the same everywhere, or angoricity, not temperature.